You have a big job.
I do.
Yeah.
And a fun job.
So we talked about this a little bit before the session, and I had done some research, obviously, for the call, for this meeting, for this discussion, but really realized that the scale is much bigger than even some of the things that I found in my research. Can you give us some idea of what the scale is of what you're trying to do when you're trying to integrate all this data for HHS?
Sure. I mean, just I think to step back and talk about the organization that is HHS, which comprises about 29 different parts. So the parts that you're most familiar with, like FDA and CMS and NIH and CDC, but it's a total of 29 different agencies. And so the enormous amount of information that we collect as a byproduct of managing all of the programs that we do, how do we begin to use that information beyond the primary reporting purposes, so the great statistics that you see and that you read in the newspapers, but how do we actually begin to leverage that information in ways that go beyond that primary purpose? And so that really is the overarching charge.
And you've been in place since 2017, and what sorts of things have you done over the period that you've been with HHS already?
Yeah, so, you know, I think we have had a tremendous history with Todd Park and others of really pushing data for researchers and entrepreneurs on what we are really proud of, healthdata.gov. The question was, how are we using those data assets internally? And as part of really pushing that internal data sharing, which we can talk a little bit more about, we really think that the method to do that is by an incremental approach. What I didn't want to spend time doing is spending the next 10 years and doing an inventory of all of HHS's data, because that would just be another inventory of HHS's data. So what we want to do is really put that data towards action. We kicked off a lot of this work by hosting an opioid codeathon, which I know some of the people here participated in. We had about 250 people come from across the country to use the 70 data sets that we put together to help advance solutions in the areas of prevention, treatment, and usage. And as we did that work, and in the process of the team really trying to make that data available, we learned a lot of information around how HHS operates when it comes to sharing data assets, whether those are the cultural barriers to data sharing, whether those are the legal and regulatory challenges, or whether, you know, technical challenges. So making a PDF available online is not helpful when it comes to making data discoverable and usable. So that was our sprint. And then since then, we've really spent an enormous amount of time. The first 6 months of last year were really about validating those problems and going to our users, whether those were the agency heads at all of the different parts of HHS, or the frontline staff that are running the programs and that need to have access to the data. So that was the work that we spent the first 6 months on. We released a report in September, which I hope everybody reads. I always say I think it's a page turner, because it really is, it's unusual for and any organization really to say, here are the problems that we're facing. Here are the challenges that we have as an organization when it comes to leveraging our own data internally. And that was really our attempt to say, we are acknowledging what the issues are, what the challenges are, as a first step to then really coming up with a roadmap to what the implementation phase should look like.
Where can people find that report?
So that is, you can go on the HHS Idea Lab website, and you'll find the report there. If you Google the current state of data sharing at HHS, not a very creative title, but that's, if you Google that, you'll land on the report. And it's not a very long read, but I think it really tells you a lot about the work that the department, I think, is really a leader in the federal government right now.
So hhs.gov/Idea Lab is one of the things I wanted to make sure we talked about in this conversation. But you mentioned culture already in this sort of discovery process. So how much of the challenge here is around cultural issues? Because you've got 29 different agencies, there are a lot of people involved in those agencies. How much of this is cultural? How much of this is really technology?
Sure. So, you know, I do want to say that part of the way that we operate is, and it seems very natural that within the silos that have existed, we are running independent programs. And so oftentimes, as those programs are run independently, the data streams are independent as well. And it is a mind shift to say that those streams should not remain in those silos, that we should, in fact, have the default way of operating as sharing rather than saying no to data sharing. So that really is the shift. It is, you may say, ultimately, it's all about culture, because changing the way people have operated for 20, 30 years is really about convincing people of the value of data sharing and how it can impact their work.
But also the governance structure as well. So there are good reasons why people are sometimes resistant to change, because they've had a way of doing things and they're not sure by making certain decisions if they're actually going to be compromising something.
Sure.
So part of your role is to put together the governance structure around this as well. I heard you speak once where you spoke about the delay in internal transfers of data were as bad or greater than the delays in external requests for data.
Absolutely. So, you know, when I was outside of HHS and working with the White House team, it took us a year to negotiate a data use agreement with HHS. When I came internally to HHS, I realized that two different parts of HHS can have the same struggle. The reason being is that healthcare data is heavily regulated, and all the different parts of HHS operate under a different set of regulations. And so the risk right now is really all at the individual level as they're negotiating these agreements, when actually it needs to be at the organizational level, and we need to really create a standard approach for how those arrangements are approached.
So you need to break down those internal challenges and structures and create new ways of working together. By doing that, do you actually begin to create better ways for internal innovation, or at least recognize where there's opportunities to reach out to the business community and the technology community and find ways that you can help to improve the way things are working?
Absolutely. I think as we, as we fix our house internally, really creating those mechanisms for data sharing with external partners are going to become much easier. And then hopefully bi-directional, so not just HHS releasing information, but also being able to have access to additional sources of information that might be much more timely than what we currently have access to. And I always say that, you know, I think data really is the mechanism through which the public and private sectors can collaborate and should collaborate to solve some of the greatest public health challenges that we have today.
So, and this challenge keeps growing by the minute, because the data sets keep growing, right? And there continues to be more in this these repositories and this architecture that creates more challenge while we're sitting here talking about it. So for the business community that's here with us, what are some of the opportunities for them to integrate and to help support some of the work that you guys are doing?
Yeah, I mean, so we learned a lot just through speaking with a lot of organizations that are doing this work. You know, there isn't really a roadmap for how to go from where we are to where we want to be, which is a more data-driven organization. And so I think to the extent that we as a community of stakeholders who all care about, existing within organizations and certainly within the government space, where we want those organizations to really operate at their maximum level, to be as efficient and as effective as possible. I think continuing to have those open learnings and sharings is incredibly important, because there isn't right now a roadmap to success. There isn't a pathway that I have. And so we will have successes and we will have failures as we do this, and we'll have to learn from how we're approaching it and learn from other organizations that are doing this as well.
You mentioned the Codeathon that you ran about a year ago, and that was focused on the opioid epidemic.
Right.
What other sorts of opportunities will there be for further Codeathons around opioids, the opioid epidemic, or other areas, and more things that are reaching out to the community like that?
Absolutely. So, you know, as I said, I think at the beginning, we've released over 2,000 data sets for public use. Mm-hmm. We would love to continue to push on that, and if there are data sets sets that people want access to. You know, I think it is our job to make sure that we do that in a responsible and secure way, but that we, again, help to provide information that can lead to solutions in the private sector. I would say the other approach really has also been through challenges and competitions that we've engaged in. And, you know, the hosting a codeathon that kept the department open overnight, maybe for the first time, put a few gray hairs for me. but I would love to do that again. Again, because I do think that we don't have all the answers to some of the biggest problems. And I think about 60% of our participants for the Codeathon actually were not coming from the healthcare field. And so to get people who are bringing such different perspectives to some of the biggest challenges, I think is incredibly important. I would like to do one again soon.
So what's moving faster than you would expect? Because government is not really known for moving quickly. So let's talk about something positive. What's happening faster than you might have expected it to change?
I would say that the push for this work, which really requires a long-term commitment and a long-term investment, has mm-hmm. been tremendous. And this is the thing that sort of brings everybody together. And so the work has been actually moving at a very, very rapid pace. So thinking about, you know, validating the problems, coming up with the roadmap and the strategy, and now for us to be in the implementation phase of that, both from a platform that enables the data sharing to happen, but also creating an overarching governance model for this organization. I think people think it's hard to start something in the private sector, and I know it is, but creating something new in the federal government with the budget cycles that we have, with the challenges that we have when it comes to bringing in talent, and working in some fairly complicated organizations, that's to be able to move at the pace that we have, I think, is a testament to folks at every level who've been involved in this work. Not really to me, but to people who have experienced the pain points of this for the last 20 years and are raising their hands and saying, yes, we want to come and work on this and help solve this.
Right.
And we're going to commit, you know, for the next 5, 10, 15 years to work on this.
Well, you just mentioned the time frame, because this is a long journey. This is not a 2-year project or a 5-year project. This is 5, 15, 20, and beyond. So what are some of the milestones that we should anticipate as you go through this and create this change and this governance structure and sharing structure?
Yeah, so, you know, we can't let complexity sort of stop us from making progress. So for me, it's really about going use case by use case. So the first use case is really bringing data and connecting data around the opioid crisis. And then we'll come up with other use cases and, again, create those pipelines that we need to. The other thing is that we're committed to making everything that we're doing as public and as transparent as possible. So the first report we made publicly available in September around the challenges, our roadmap, we hope to make that publicly available as well soon, and to get feedback from other organizations and other individuals who may have, may be in the thick of it as well. And so I think that should be the expectation, this bias sort of towards action and transparency and being able to share that information.
I want to make sure the audience in the room and everyone who's watching the live stream can go and find more resources. So you mentioned hhs.gov, healthdata.gov. Where else should they go? What other sorts of things should they look for to find out more about what you guys are doing?
So you can go to the HHS website, but I would say that the Office of the CTO website and the HHS Idea Lab websites are going to be where you'll see a lot of the updates around the data portfolio for the department.
If there's something that startups who are listening to this can do better that you would encourage them to do, is there any key advice that you'd have for early stage businesses?
I would say both from my clinical hat and from my job at the federal government level, just validating the problems. I hear a lot of pitches from a lot of people, and I think understanding the pain points that your customer has. I know we hear about that all the time. But come and spend some time with us. We'll be happy to sit down and tell you some of the issues that we're facing. And I think that those are probably going to be true and consistent across the healthcare sector when it comes to issues around data and interoperability.
Anything that we've got a few seconds left. Anything else you want to say that I haven't asked you about?
So I will say this. A lot of people ask me, why I work in the federal government. And my pitch to anybody who's ever interested is that there really is no place where you can have more impact at scale and work on some of the toughest problems that are facing the healthcare sector today. And so, if you want to sit down and talk about maybe potentially spending some time, there are many ways of getting involved, and we would love to have more people come and spend some time.
Please join me in thanking Dr. Mona Siddiqui.
Thank you.